Rabbi Kahana, your eviction plan is flawed. Halakhically, because I am not aware of one halakhic authority who supports it. You dream a Jewish state that is a halakhic state. On what halakha do you base your plan? Can you cite one major rabbi who supports your position? Tactically, some have claimed that you are the person most responsible for the rejuvenation of Palestinian Arab nationalism. Since 1967, hundreds of thousands of Palestinian Arabs left Judea Samaria on their own. But by going to their villages and insisting they leave, you have instilled within them a greater resolve to remain. Have you yourself become the greatest enemy of your plan to free Israel of Arabs? Ethically, your plan turns Arabs into chattel who are moved about like animals. How do you view the Palestinian Arabs? The media has quoted you as addressing them as dogs. If this is true, what of the principle that every human being is created in the image of God? Rabbi Kahana, how do you feel justified in imposing upon Israel the eviction principle if the dangers of doing so are so great? And if the halakhic moral power against it are so great? Rabbi Greenberg, on the other hand, elements of Rabbi Kahana's plan may be correct. As an historian, you know that exchanges of populations have often taken place. Isn't Rabbi Kahana saying the same thing? 1 million Jews were expelled from Arab countries since 1948 without compensation. And the transfer of 1 million Arabs would but complete the exchange. Politically, Rabbi Kahana's plan may be the only way to save the Jewish state. Many fear that even if Israel withdraws from the disputed lands, that the Arabs will constitute the majority population within the 1967 borders in 30 to 40 years. Through democratic means, they will undo the Jewish nature of the state, including the law of return. Are you, Rabbi Greenberg, prepared to accept the workings of democracy, even if it results in a state which is no longer a Jewish state? And halakhically, as I understand Rabbi Kahana's plan, it would allow peaceful Arabs to remain in Israel with individual rights, but without political rights, including citizenship and the right to vote. Does halakha limit the political rights of non-Jews in a Jewish state? Are there any limits that you would place on Arab political rights? Would you allow an Arab to become a cabinet member, the defense minister, or prime minister? Or for that matter, would you allow Arabs to join the Israeli army en masse? Is the granting to Arabs of equal political rights a democratic ideal rather than a Jewish halakhic
one? 10 days ago, I was at home in Israel. And the most depressing part about this evening has already begun. I have to debate the issue of whether Israel should save itself. What normal people would debate such an issue? In 1945, the Poles and the Czechs, having learned to the horrors and the bitter misery what 12 million ethnic Germans who had lived in their country for 1,000 years had done to them as a fifth column, bringing on Hitler in 1938 and 1939. Expelled 12 million ethnic Germans without having any debate in any synagogue or church. They were normal people. There must be something wrong about the Jewish people to debate the issue whether we are going to allow people, Palestinians who in the 1920s and 1930s and 1940s, before there was a Jewish state, raced through the country, massacring hundreds of Jews, shouting, "Ibahalu," slaughter the Jew, whether we should do something about it. most responsible for the rejuvenation of the Palestinian nationalism. There's no question. It was I. Inside of the Arabs in 1929 and Hebron to massacre 67 Jews in one day. There was no question that it was I who persuaded them to turn down the 1947 UN partition plan and to go to war. It was I who caused the Six-Day War and the 73 War. There was no question that it is Kahana who is the blame for all these things. There was no question. What insanity. And most of the way came to the Arabs. The Arabs are Palestinians, and they believe it. And they hate Rabbi Greenberg as much as they hate Kahana. The difference is that they respect me in their own way. We're saying what every normal Jew really thinks it's hard. Arabs have left the West Bank? What nonsense. It's a fraud. A fraud whereby you put in Shriyah so it's not allowed to speak about moving out the Arabs. The Arabs who left the West Bank all went to work in the Gulf States. They are now coming back in droves by the tens of thousands. Channel, image of God, of course all people are made in the image of God. So is Hitler. He had just gone and Stalin. Therefore we should not have bombed the Germans. Of course not. The question is not whether one is made in the image of God. The question is, what does he do to that image after he's born? Halakha. I'm a man of halakha. I don't want to have to. I don't have the time. Another minute and a half. My God, halacha is clear that the non-Jew does not have the status of a Jew. Democracy is not Judaism. That may be painful to modern Orthodox. Of course, it's painful. It's too bad. That's halacha. What shall I? Shall I read to you a Rambam? I can read to you so. So many, many more things. The halakha is clear that a non-Jew wishes to live in Israel must accept receive avud, tribute and servitude. And I want to read to you the definition of servitude by the Rambam, who is, of course, one of the great progressive Jews. He was a doctor. In Hilchot Melachim, the Law of Kings, very Rambam, chapter 6, halakha. And the servitude that they must take upon themselves in order to be allowed to live in Eretz Israel. Sheyun nivzim, they shall be humiliated, ushpeyun yamata, and low. Velo yamin worship long Israel, they shall not lift their head in Israel. Elen ushitata yadam. Let me just finish the line. And they shall not be appointed over Jews to anything ever, including a Knesset.
That means that the Jews are 82% of the population of Israel, the non-Jewish population 18%, and that lumps together the Druze, who, as you well know, are on our side, if we assumed all the Arabs on the other side. Furthermore, the Arab birth rate is dropping in Israel. In 1975, it was 46 per thousand. In 1980, it was 38 per thousand. In 1985, it was 34 per thousand. Because the Arabs are going through the same process that lowered the Jewish birth rate. Wealth rises, education rises, birth drops. The Arab women in particular, in the West Bank, in the Green Line, the Arab women, as they get educated, there's a sharp drop in birth rate because, in fact, they have other alternatives than just fulfilling themselves through family. The result of this is that the Jewish birth rate is leveling off. In the same period, 1975, the Jewish birth rate, which is lower, it was then at 25 per thousand, dropped in 1922, and remains at 22 in 1985. In other words, the Jewish rate has leveled off while the Arab rate is just beginning to drop. And at the present time, because the Jewish population is in fact almost five times as large as the Arab population, in fact, Jewish births within the Green Line outnumber the Arabs. So far from growing larger, the truth is that the population growth of the Jews is larger than the Arabs, and the absolute numbers of difference has widened. 855,000 Jews have been added to the population of Israel since 1975-1985, as compared to some 200-some-thousand Arab population. So in fact, in absolute numbers, the margin has widened. This is no allowance for Jewish immigration aliyah if Soviet Jewry gets out. This is no allowance for Arabs going out of Israel as they have, and as you heard before, and the numbers coming back don't compare to those who have left. This is no allowance for the very fact that the whole possibility of the Jewish population itself getting rising in birth rate as it has begun to in response in part to the sense of the challenge. In short, the Hebrew University demographers asked by the government to project the Jewish population of Israel by 2020 at the minimum, at the most pessimistic projection, projected a 75% Jewish population. In 2020, that's about 15 years after Meir Kahane predicted the Arab majority. And that, of course, is assuming again that there'll be no further changes. At the present rate of drop, it would take 300 years before the possibility of an equal population, and even that possibility depends on a set of projections that makes no sense. So why is this important? And why are we discussing demographics? It is important for one central question. You know, Meir Kahane and I go back to high school days together. I'll skip that story. He always had a wonderful imagination, but he never did his homework. And why is it that it's so important in this particular case? Because what is he telling us? What do we call transfer population as euphemism? What he's telling us is that do you think the Arabs will go quietly? Is that the term we're talking about? Can you picture the scenes? Not that anything that monstrous will ever be done by Israel. Mothers and children clinging to their home, crying, old people crippled. When asked what he would do, Baltimore Jewish Times, August 23, 1985, Meir Kahane said, and I quote, "Believe me when Meir Kahane says they must go, they'll flee. Question, but if they refuse, quote, we'll put them on trucks and send them over the Allenby Bridge." And if they resist, I will tear Kriya shortly, the Jews could afford that. And if they resist, what scene does it remind you of? You know as well as I. What scene it reminds you of? It's the trucks ramping up our women and children. That's what it reminds me of. So another flood of cry, people leaving this cry. And if they resist, God, I quote, we will use force. And if they fire our soldiers, we will kill them. Tragic choices. If Israel, facing nuclear holocaust, had to fight back with nuclear bombs. But as a substitute for thinking against the facts that oppose this sloppily and easily, violates the fundamentals of Jewish tradition and Jewish law. So the answer is that the notion that there can be a population exchange, that we would consciously choose to expel Arabs with violence and with force, is a violation of the most fundamental Jewish rights and would be an assault not only on Jewish standing and on Jewish morality, but on the very security of the state of Israel.
Listening to the description of Israel, I wondered where I was living. The Galilee today is a majority of them, today, about 15 years and about 15 minutes. In the Western Galilee, according to the figures by the same book, 82% of Western Galilee is Arab. That is Arab, Northern Ireland. Have you ever been to Akko, except to, as a tourist? Jaffa, Ramleh, Lod, these are cities that are rapidly turning Arab. The only reason why the Jews are still a majority in Israel, the only reason, is because there was a huge aliyah of Sephardic Jews. That aliyah has dried up. I hope to God that the Soviet Jews come, but ain't something on this. One doesn't depend on miracles. In the meantime, the Sephardic birth rate has dropped far more than the Arab birth rate has, and that is the real problem. But more importantly, long before the Arabs are a majority, what happens when they become a third? And they join together in a coalition government with the extreme left. Is that what you want? Is that what you want? Who is a Jew? Decided by one third of the Knesset Arab. Above all, the major thing is, there is halakha here. And if there is one Arab in the country who is not prepared to accept the status that is given him by the halakha, that Arab must go too. And we bow our heads to halakha, or we are not Orthodox brothers. The final point. Of course, it pains me. Many things pain me. I suppose had I been of age in World War II, I might have been pained at the thought of Allied bombers bombing German cities. Thank God they, and not I, had the same.
Meir Kahane repeats the Knesset against the halakha that in fact it denies Gentiles all rights, etc., etc. What are the facts? The very Rambam ruling he quotes on the spot the Raiva challenges in the Yerushalayim, but I'm not much beyond the Raiva. It is the overwhelming testimony from Yosef Karo in the Shulchan Aruch, down from the Be'iri in the 12th century, down to the leading rabbis of our day, that in fact, quote the Shulchan Aruch, "Ein kol dvarim elo amurim elo osa zman," these are said only at that time, that is to say with Gentiles who are immoral, dissolute, and avud the Avodah Zarah specifically, idolaters, they're not considered idolaters, and none of these laws apply. Rabbi Avadia Yosef, the chief Sephardic rabbi, summarized his survey of the literature, and I quote, "In the views of the majority of the Rishonim, the prohibition does not apply to Muslims as they do not worship idolatry. Quote, in everyone's view, the Kol HaDeos in this time, the prohibition does not apply. Thirdly, in the view of among the greatest decisors, earlier or later, the prohibition does not apply, but applies only to Gentile idolaters who are not Gentile idolaters. By agreement of the community," and I conclude with this final comment, "and its leaders, democracy is permitted to appoint, any common post, any communal post, any political job, not only converts, but absolutely the Gentiles going the murder. In short, the overwhelming consensus of responsible rabbis of any halakhic standing or learning or mention of kind is that these laws do not apply to Arabs or to Christians who are not idolaters, and therefore he is using it totally out of context. In order to make the halakha to be a cruel, atrocity-ridden, antagonistic to Gentiles. The truth is, I would say the opposite, that there should be no limits to Arab rights because, in fact, in a democracy, this gives them a chance to grow and become integrated into the society and to commit itself to that society. Democracy is the best fulfillment, I believe, of the vision of the breed of the Jewish covenant that God asks us as humans to take full responsibility." And as the Rambam concludes his statement, "To those who show love to Gentiles, even the Akron that he said all those terrible things about, he said, when I show them love, with Nedarki Shalom," and he says, as the Torah says, quote, "Tov Hashem Matov Barach Rav HaKol Masav," imitate God. God shows goodness and compassion to all his creatures. All the ways of the Torah are Drachel Darchenon, Machol Masiva Sev Shalom. Its paths are the paths of peace. Every word you heard was therefore a violation of the most fundamental principles of the Torah, as
as defined by the rabbis from the Ramadan throughout time.